Welcome to Elim, both here and online. Today we celebrate our gospel heritage in song. You voted last Sunday, and we'll enjoy the results throughout the service. Before we do that, we are going to do something that's most important, and that's pray. So let's pray together. Our Lord and Savior, we welcome you to our service. May the shared experience of hope and your faithfulness by Christian brothers and sisters over the centuries inspire us. Help us to open our hearts and minds to your divine presence at Elim through song and through the preaching of your word. Bless all present. Bless Pastor Steve as he shares your word. In your name we pray. Amen. Our seventh place song tied with I Stand Amazed. And it's based on Deuteronomy 33. The eternal God is a dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms. You can guess which song it is. Written in 1887, our first song is Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, and I have a choir to help me out. So come and take your place, and please stand as we sing our seventh place song, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Musicians and a few of Elim choir members from the years past are helping us enjoy all these testimonies put in song. And the music we sing this morning goes as far back as 1772. Yeah. And some of our Christmas carols are even older than that. So, I mean, this isn't unusual. When Frances Crosby was 6 weeks old in 1820, she caught a cold. And the treatment blinded her. She grew up to write 8,000 hymns and gospel songs with 100 million copies sold. She taught and funded rescue missions. A little blind girl who changed the world and ours because she understood the gospel of Romans 8, the blessed assurance. Okay, our sixth place song, written in 1873, Blessed Assurance.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation,
Good job, didn't she? And that's just one of her songs. Our fifth place song is the newest one, and it was written in 1912, The Old Rugged Cross.
I love our
In 1896, the fourth place song was written in Ohio. It is called I Surrender All. Did you choose that one? How many people chose I Surrender All? Yeah, it's a good song. Okay, here we go from 1896.
Thank you.
Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you, choir and musicians. And the excitement builds to find out which were the top three songs. So you'll just have to wait because it's announcement time. Again, we welcome you. And if you are new or visiting, please fill in a visitor's card and hand it in at the desk where the coffee is as you are leaving. And make sure you say hello to someone and tell them your name. If you take your bulletin, please notice the fundraiser insert. Very important for our friend Barry Morris on August 18th at 7 o'clock at First Baptist. It's going to be a wonderful concert with Freedom's Voice and to raise funds to retrofit Barry's home after he's had a stroke. So if you can go, that would be wonderful. Show support for him and definitely with finances. Now, Bill is playing the drums today, praise the Lord, and he is in charge of 1,000 Voices at the Cross, and he needs volunteers still, correct? Yeah, for this incredible community outreach. So if you have some teenagers in your family, extended family, that have some muscles or want to help, see Bill today, and it would be wonderful. This is such a citywide event, and we really want to get behind it and make sure you tell people about it as well. It's great to come together in unity under that cross, and sunset behind it is spectacular. You've noticed that there's a farewell for the Arabas on the 25th, and Steve's going to be preaching a little later today. I don't know if Brian and Cheryl Haynes are here, but they are proud parents of a grandson born August 8th. And he's healthy, Ren Haynes. So congratulations to the... Oh, there they are. There's Grandpa, Grandma at the back, smiling ear to ear. And he's just precious. I saw his picture, and we look forward to meeting him very soon. Thank you for giving this month to reach Elam's monthly budget. God bless you as you sacrifice and worship by giving your offerings either at the back table. There's a place where our ushers have an offering plate, or you can e-transfer. And speaking of e-transfer, also our list for St. Vincent at the back. Beverly's here today, so if you want to talk to her, she's up at the front vis-a-vis anything for St. Vincent. We're still collecting clothes. Yes, okay, important. Yes, everything in the bulletin, we're still doing that. So please participate. They say being a Christian is never dull. There's always something going on, something that we can do. It's wonderful. So I'm going to dismiss the children to their programs downstairs. God bless you, each one of you, and your leaders as you learn more about the Savior. And while they make their way out, I'm going to introduce the third place song, written in 1873. This inspiring song was written through great sorrow. Horatio Spafford was a successful attorney and real estate investor who lost a fortune in the Great Chicago Fire of 1871. Around the same time, his beloved four-year-old son died of scarlet fever. Thinking a vacation would do his family good, he sent his wife and four daughters on a ship to England and planned to join them later. Their ship was in a terrible collision and sank. 200 people drowned, including all four of Spafford's daughters. His wife survived and sent a telegram. It said, "Saved alone, what shall I do?" He immediately set sail for England, and the captain of the ship told Spafford when they were passing over the spot in the ocean where the shipwreck occurred that took his daughters' lives. As he thought of his daughters, words of comfort and hope filled his heart and his faith in life eternal for his family. He wrote his thoughts down in our beloved third place hymn. I'll have the choir join me. It is well with my soul. together for the remainder of this song.
It is well.
Thank you because it is well with our souls. We thank you because we know that for every single thing we go through, your word remains steadfast because your word makes us to understand that nothing will change with your word because your word lasts forever, stands forever. And so God, in your presence, we declare that it is well with our souls. We declare that it is well with everything that you have given us. We declare that it is well with our minds, with our bodies, even in your presence, in Jesus' name. Father, we ask concerning the prayers, the prayer requests in the bulletin, God, we ask that for everyone that is looking up to you for healing, for everyone that is looking up to you for one request or another, that you will meet them at the point of their needs. You will touch them and heal them and give them the reason to give glory to your heavenly name forever in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Please give a hand to the music team. Please be seated. Okay. Oh, it's a joy to bring God's word to you again today. And it's a little bit emotional for me today. I hope I don't cry. Because the very first time that I would preach on this stage was just almost exactly 2 years ago, August 15, 2021. Is that 2 years or 3 years now? Yeah, 3 years. And it's almost like I'm not preaching my last message, but it's, I don't know. I don't know what words to say, but it's indeed an opportunity to have been able to bring the word of God to you, to the Elam family all through these years, and also being given the opportunity by the leadership of the assembly to do so. So please, you pardon me if at different points my voice is a little bit shaky. I'm a very emotional person, if you don't know. Wow. God is good. And all the time. Weeks ago, we talked about what happens when it seems like you're praying and you don't get answers. Last week, we talked about the purpose of prayer, and today we're going to be talking about how to actually get answers when you pray. And the reason that I have been talking about prayers, about prayer, is because God gave me a word, and I wrote it down. He said that I'm going to do something mighty in Sault Ste. Marie. It's going to be obvious as the mining fire flares in the day and as the undeniable as it is at nighttime. Something is going to happen in Sault Ste. Marie that will halt the city in its tracks, and for about three to five days, and after that, people will begin to call on the name of the Lord. The churches should be ready. And the word for the Elim Assembly is that God has called Elim Pentecostal Tabernacle to a position of leadership in the community of churches in Sault Ste. Marie. This will not be easy, but her hands will be strengthened to help the churches and lead them in the right path for insight and impact in this city. Soon, pastors, leaders, and key people in the city will start to look to Elim for help, support, and answers. It is time for the church to grow and elevate her spiritual capacity through fasting and prayers, seeking more of the face of God than ever before. Be ready. This is what God has said concerning the city and the church assembly. And so it is important, one of the ways that we can elevate ourselves spiritually is when we spend time praying. And the beautiful thing is that we have a community where a lot of people are middle-aged and above, or we have more seniors in the community, which means a lot of people are retired. And so if you're retired, that means you have a lot more time to pray. Okay? So I believe that's an opportunity. Amen? So today, we're talking about getting answers. When we read through the Bible, you know, last week we talked about the purpose of prayer, and we looked at, you know, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We read everything and talked about the fact that the purpose of prayer itself is to establish the will of God upon the earth. So when we're talking about getting answers, it looks more in the direction of how do we use, knowing the purpose of prayer, how do we use that to exactly bring about God's purpose in the city, in the church, over our lives and over everything that we're seeking the face of God for. In James chapter 5, verse 17 to 18, the Bible talks about Elijah. Elijah was a human being, even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. Now, oftentimes when we look at this scripture, one of the things that we see is, oh, Elijah was a prophet. He prayed, and you know, he prayed earnestly. He prayed fervently. And he shut the heavens. And when it was time, after 3.5 years, he went back, he prayed. And then, you know, there was rain. Oftentimes, we use this scripture as a description of how to pray fervently so that you'd get answers. But there's a prelude to what happened to about this scripture. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 11, verse 16 to 17, God was talking to Israel here. He said, be careful, or you will be enticed to turn away and worship other gods and bow down to them. Then the Lord's anger will burn against you, and he will shut up the heavens so that it will not rain, and the ground will yield no produce, and you will soon perish from the land that the Lord is giving you. So there was something that God had already said. God had already set something in motion, which was a law. He said, if you, as the people of God, Israel, then, he said, if you go against the laws. If you serve other gods, this is what will happen. You will not have rain, and you will suffer even in the land that God has given you. So by the time it was 1 Kings 17, verse 1, where it talked about where Elijah was talking to Ahab, and he said, "As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, whom I serve, there will be neither dew nor rain for the next few years, except at my word." Now, of course, as a person, he was declaring a word to the king because Israel had gone bonkers at the time. They had begun to worship other gods and do stuff. Most of us will remember the time Elijah called down fire from the heavens. Do we remember that story? When he had that challenge against the prophets of Baal, about 400 of them, and it was like, okay, it was more or less like a contest. It says, okay, you call on your God, and whichever God that answers by fire will be the God of Israel. So there was that contest, and then I think for a whole day or more, the prophets or the priests of Baal, they kept trying to call down fire, and it didn't happen. And then at the instant that Elijah called down fire, fire consumed the sacrifice, and of course the prophets of Baal were killed and all of that. Now, as we look at this manner of prayer, there was something that God had already said. So when Elijah went to meet the king to say, hey, this is what is going to happen, there will be no rain, he was talking about what God had already said. So the moment he said there will be no rain, God had already said, if you guys, you know, serve other gods, you will have no rain. But apparently at the time he said this, there was still rain, you know, everybody was still feeling good. So when Elijah said there will be no rain, and then he went on ahead to pray about it, he was praying exactly what God had said. So the only way that we can get answers to our prayers is when we know exactly what God has said about whatever the situation we're praying about. So when we look through our lives and we're praying about certain things and it looks like it's not happening, the first thing we need to know is, what has God said? And how do you enact these things? There are about four steps or four things that I'd want us to note. Because as Christians, there are different levels of what we experience in the way we get answers to prayers. Sometimes we just know it, we have a knowledge about it, that, oh, God answers prayers, but we do not exactly experience it in our personal lives. So the first thing, one of the things that we need to note is that we do not pray to get answers. We pray because the answers are already there. For every single time we pray, we are praying the will of God, which means it is exactly what God has said would happen that we are asking to be established in our lives. So if what we're praying for is some level of provision, some level of healing, whatever the challenge is, first of all, what has God said about it? And then when we kneel down to pray, we pray that thing into our lives. So if God says that that you are healed by the stripes of Jesus, what do you do when you have an ailment? You keep praying, Father, this is what you have said about my health challenge. And it is in that vein that we're going to be able to get the most out of it. Now let's take a look at this story. The prodigal son in Luke chapter 15 from verse 17 to 20. There was a particular statement. We do know this prodigal son, right? Okay. We don't know the prodigal son? Okay. All right. Now, the prodigal son was a guy who looked at his dad and was like, okay, you know what? I don't care, you're taking too long to die. I want my inheritance. And then the father gave him the inheritance, and he went into, you know, other parts of the country and squandered the money. And at some point, he was so broke, he was going to be eaten with pigs. He was hired to be feeding the swine. And then he was so broke, the only thing that looked edible was what he was feeding the pigs. And so at some point, the Bible says in those verses that he came to himself. He said, when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? The first thing that we have to know when we are praying to get answers is we get answers from a position of relationship. There has to be a relationship between you and the God that you are praying to. Now, of course, we know that God is merciful. He will always answer prayers at different points. The Bible makes us to understand that he makes rain to fall on the unjust and unto the just. So there will be some kind of things that people will pray about that would be answered. But especially for you as a child of God, you have to be conscious about the fact that I am God's child. And if you know that you're God's child, you would act differently. You would ask differently. I think there was a time when I was using an example here, and I said that if you were Jeff Bezos' son or daughter, would you be afraid to ask for, let's say, $10,000? Or if you were Bill Gates' son or daughter, would you be afraid to ask for $10,000? Yes? Yeah. No? Okay, if you would be afraid to ask for $10,000, let me see your hand. Okay, a few people. If you would be very confident to ask for $10,000, let me see your hand. Okay, many more hands. Why? Because you know he has so much money to go around the world, in fact. So $10,000, how much is $10,000? Now, for you, as a child of God, you know that God loves you. Something you have to always understand is he loves you regardless. Sometimes the enemy comes to us and makes us feel like, oh, because you've committed that sin, because you did something wrong, oh, God is not going to answer you anymore. God loves you regardless. The Bible says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So even before you knew to be born again, before you knew to become a child of God, God already made provision for your sins in the past, the present, and the future because he loves you that much. The Bible says that if he has given his own son, how much more shall he not give you all things? Which means for every single time you approach God, that thing you think you are asking for, he will give it to you because you are his son. And so when the prodigal son thought to himself, he remembered that, oh, you know what? Even though I have messed up, I am a father's son, at least. Because I've messed up, I don't expect him to take me back as a son. But he knew the character of his father. And so because of that, he was confident enough to make up a speech and say, you know what? This is what I'm going to tell my dad when I get there. But he recognized by the time he was speaking to his dad, the first word that came out of his mouth was father, which means he understood his relationship. Because oftentimes we will never get anything from God if we think we're not worthy. So your relationship, the relationship you have with God right now, be confident in it because God loves you and will always love you. He said, I have loved you with an everlasting love. With my loving kindness have I drawn you. So there is nothing you can ever do. There is nothing you've ever done. There is nothing you will ever that you're doing that can separate you from the love of God. Does that make sense? So when you're coming to God, you have to be confident that God is your Father. He loves you and he's willing to give you what you're asking for. The Bible makes us to understand that I think in the book of James, it says, a double-minded person shall not obtain anything. Which means if you think that, okay, while I'm praying, maybe God would love me enough because I've attended church enough. There are some people that come to church because they think, you know, it's in the number of times I come to church that God would then consider, he needs that car. Let's give it to him. He's been to church a number of times. That's not the way God thinks. God is with you whether you're in church or not. Come to church, though, okay? Come to church. God is with you everywhere you are. The Bible makes us to understand that the Holy Spirit is with us everywhere. So even when you thought you were sinning behind closed doors, the Holy Spirit was right there looking at you. Because he's always there. He's everywhere. So how would he not see you? So the moment you go to God and say, God, I'm sorry, he's still there. God never leaves you. God will never forsake you. Okay? That's the first thing. You have to understand that prayer of faith, the prayer that gets answered, must come within the confines of an existing relationship. Number two, your prayer, getting answers to your prayer, must come from the understanding of what God has already done. In Matthew 6:10, it talks about your will be done in earth as it is in heaven. There is nothing, the Bible helps us to understand that when God created the world, he looked at everything and saw that it was good. So there's nothing that you're expecting God to do that is not already done. Okay? So you have to see it from the perspective of everything that I'm about to ask God for has already been provided. Because if it is will, then it is already done. And so when I'm asking for it, all I'm asking for is the expression of that will in my, you know, in my present experience. And that is what our prayers are. God is not about to figure out whether you need health. In heaven, there's no sickness. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So when you need provision, the will of God says that God is your provider. He has given you all things that pertains to life and godliness. How shall he not freely give you all things? So his will is that you have that which you need. So you have to always understand that what you are asking for is already available. So from the perspective of children, you know, maybe your children to you, there may be things that they will ask for that is not readily available, maybe because you still have to make a purchase or whatever it is. But in the case of God, he doesn't need to make a purchase. He doesn't need to figure out how he's going to get it. It's already available. There's nothing you can ever think or ask or dare to imagine that is not already available according to God's will. So when you're going to God, you're going with the understanding that what you need is already available. And so when you look at it from that perspective, when I kneel down to pray, to ask for whatever it is, I know it's already available. So it's not a case of whether maybe God will be able to get it or not. It's already available. So, and these are some of the things that build our faith, the confidence to come before God to because we know that everything I'm asking for, because I'm his son, it's already available. I am going to get it. And this would definitely help you when you pray. Number three, when we look at the prodigal son, one of the things that he did, he understood that he had a relationship. He understood that he could be hired as a servant. He didn't know that it was available that he could be a son again. So he understood that what he was going to ask for was actually possible, given the character of the father. And so the next one is alignment with the purposes of God. Last week, we talked about the purpose of prayer, to establish the will of God in your present life's experience or in whatever you are asking God for. When you align with the purpose of God, what God will do is make ready all the things that you're asking for. In 1 Corinthians 3:22, it says, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or future, all things are yours. So it's here, it was talking about, I mean, there was some contention there in the Corinthian church, but as essentially what Paul was talking about here, he was trying to say, you know what, you don't need to be choosing what you think is better. Everything belongs to you. He has given you all things that pertains to life and godliness. The things that you are already asking for, they are already yours. You just need to ask for it. What is the will of God, and how do we know the will of God? The will of God is right there in the Bible. What has God said about this thing? If he says that I have it already according to his word, it's just about taking his word back to him to say, God, this is what you have said about my health. This is what you have said about my job. This is what you have said about my finances. This is what you have said about my businesses. You said that whatsoever I lay my hands upon to do shall prosper. This is what you have said about my children, that they are for signs and wonders. And so if anything is going wrong with my child, God, I take my word back to you to say, this is what you have said about my children. If it's not happening, I need it to happen. And that is the will of God. So regardless of whatever situation you're in, God has said something about it. When you take his word back to him, the Bible say, God was saying in the Bible that, you know, remind me of my words. It's not like he forgot, but he wants you to be certain about the things that you know he has said, and that is the way that you get answers from him. So for every single time that we look up to God and say, and look forward to maybe even the salvation of the city, what has God said? The Bible says in, I think it's in Psalm 2 verse 8, that ask of me of the nations, and I'll give you the inheritance of the heathen. If I quoted that right. Yeah, ask of me, and I'll give thee the nations for thy inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the world, of the earth, for thy possession. So he's saying that just ask. No matter what you want, just ask. I know that there are two instances, or two very common instances, or popular instances in the Bible, where a king was speaking to, I think the king was speaking to Esther at some point when Esther approached him. It was like, oh, what do you want? And then he says, up to half of my kingdom, I'm going to give it to you. It happened also around the time that John the Baptist was going to be beheaded. The king said, what do you want? You know, name whatever you want. Up to half of, even if it's up to half of my kingdom, I'm going to give it to you. Now, that is the power of a king, you know, and he could do that if he wanted. But God has everything. So he's saying that it does not matter the magnitude of what you're asking for. He can give it to you. As long as you can find it in his written word, and he said that he will give it to you, then remind him of his word. And that is how to pray according to the will of God. In Jeremiah 33, verse 3, it says, call unto me, and I will answer you, and tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. Which means even beyond the things that you are dreaming to ask, oh, maybe this is too much. He says, I will answer you and give you more. The prodigal son went to his father to say, oh, you know what? I just want to be a hired servant. The father answered him and gave him more. So God is not the one who is time tracking you on the times when you were good or when you were bad. He's just father, and that's all he wants to be to you. Now, we understand that when Jesus came to the earth, he died for the sins of the world and all. But something that we do not register in our minds is the moment he died, The Bible makes us to understand that we were crucified with Christ. And when Jesus rose up from the grave, we rose up with him. Which means every single time God looks at you, he sees Jesus. He doesn't see the Steve or the Charles or whoever. He sees Jesus. So when you appear before God in prayer, it is like Jesus by himself asking God for whatever he's asking. So, and this is where the enemy robs us of the confidence to go to God in prayer to say, God, this is what I need. We start thinking, oh, maybe because of some of the things that I've done, the habits that I'm still struggling with, maybe God won't answer me. According to his will, he has made provisions to cover you. And according to his will, when you ask what you need, God will answer. So what is that thing that you're asking God for? Another thing that we need to do is when we have asked God for the things that we're believing for, a step that we oftentimes do not take is oftentimes we expect that God will just somehow answer that prayer. But when we ask God in faith, God is also expecting us to make a move. So for every single time you trust God for healing, every single time you trust God for provision, every single time you trust God for the salvation of a city, the question is, what are you doing in the line of the fulfillment of that prayer? So we could pray, we could gather in church for years and pray our lungs out. But if we do not go outside to evangelize, nothing will happen. Because God will still require some effort on your own part, to execute that answer to that prayer. And that is what faith is. You work out the faith in the line of the prayer of the answers you're looking for. So if it's a question of health, what is that challenge that you're going through that maybe there's some form of a change in maybe in the way you are able to do things? Keep trying to do a little bit more than that health challenge would allow you. And then see if, you know, there's a change, because that's the way you exercise your faith. God, I'm believing you for health, for healing in my bones or healing in a part of my body. What is that ailment and what was it restricting you from doing? So when I say I have faith, I keep checking. If it's impeding the way I walk, I keep checking. Just a few weeks ago, I made a trip to visit with a friend. And for some reason, he uses the gym a lot. He runs, he jumps around, and he's quite muscular. And one of the mornings, he was like, oh, let's go for a run. And then I joined him on the run. I was like, I don't want to run because, I mean, I just sit around all day. But he forced me. He didn't force me, but I was like, okay, well, you're talking too much about this. Let's go. And then we went on a jog for 45 minutes. I don't know how I survived. Somehow I survived. But by the time that, you know, exercise was done, I developed a very, very, I would call it acute pain, because I haven't had that pain in a long time, any pain like that in a long time in my right knee. And I remember I took the Holy Communion and it's like, God, I trust you for healing. Just help me, because I didn't want to come to church limping. And I knew that my body was not wired for that kind of exertion. But what was I doing as I prayed that God would give me the healing in my right knee? What I was doing was I was walking up and down the steps in my house. And it would pain me. God, I thank you for my healing. God, I thank you for my healing. Now, did it get healed immediately? No, but you can't see me limping now, do you? Now, that, you know, we could say, oh, he's still a young boy, he can take it. But the truth is, it applies across board for every single thing. Every single thing you're believing God for. If you're believing God for increase in finances, and one of the things you could do is either you work or you start a business. Have you tried to get a job? Have you cleaned up your resume? I mean, I know a lot of people are not looking for jobs here, but you probably have trust funds working for you. Now, but you know, what are you doing in the line of what you're believing God for? So if you're trusting God for the salvation of a friend, you have to have some kind of interaction with that friend. You know, you pray in the closet, you come out in the open, have an interaction with that person. You don't have to always, sometimes as Christians, especially when we're thinking about salvation of a city, we're quick to, oh, let's just invite them to church. No, it doesn't stop there. Or let's just give them tracts. No, it doesn't stop there. Oh, I'll forward a message to them on iMessage or WhatsApp or Facebook, or I put something beautiful on my Facebook, she'll read it. No, it doesn't stop there. The Bible says, go you into all the world and preach the gospel. It involves some, action, you know, from you. And so this is the simple principle of how to get answers to prayers. Every single time you pray, there has to be the consciousness that you come with, that God has answers to all the prayers that I'm praying. 3 weeks ago, we talked about the times when it seems like prayers are not being answered. Sometimes God will come to you in his power. Sometimes he comes to you in his wisdom. But you have to always trust that God has an answer to every prayer that you pray. So when you come to him, it's not maybe he will answer this time, maybe he won't. It is God has an answer. Whether it is by his power or by his wisdom, he has an answer and he will give me an answer. Now, the other part to the exercise of your faith is going to do something in the line of what you're asking God for, no matter what that thing is. Now, I do understand that, you know, maybe as we grow older, sometimes mobility might be a challenge. But, you know, the Bible says we should pray the Lord of the harvest to send forth, laborers into the field. That is also something you can do to engage. So when you're praying and you're asking God for something, the question is, what are you doing in the line of what you are asking him for? Because 1 million times zero is still zero. So if even God has given you all the answers and you do nothing, then you will still see nothing. And that is one of the problems that we have as Christians. We just think, oh, if it's the Lord's will, he will do something about it. Something miraculous will happen. Yes, the miracles will happen, but the miracles start with you making a move. Does that make sense? And so when we look through every prayers that we've been praying, maybe some of the ones that seem delayed, check the will. What has God said about it? Have I prayed in the line of the will? If I've prayed in the line of the will and I have not seen the answer, then I will see the wisdom of God from it. I will see the power of God from it. But for every single time that you pray, you have to be making a move. And so when you make the move, then you will see the miracles. Then you will see the answers. But you cannot sit where you are. And I say this also in the line of what I believe that God has told me about the city and the church, is we need to do a lot more than we are doing right now. Because if we don't, it would seem as though that prophecies do not get fulfilled. It would seem as though God does not answer prayers. But sometimes, even your prophecy is looking at you. It's like, I need this guy to move. I need this girl to do something. I need it. Because that is prophecies don't get fulfilled except we partner with that prophecy, knowing fully well that that is what God has said. At different points, we'll get words of prophecy in the house here where God will say, I will help you. Or where God will say, do not be discouraged. I will give you half courage. These are things that tell us what we need to do in the line of what God has already said. When we read through the Bible, or Joshua 1:8, it says, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but therein shall thou meditate day and night. And then it goes ahead to say, then you shall make your way prosperous, and you shall have good success, which means regardless of how much of the word that you have in you, how much of the will of God that you have as a knowledge, how much of what God has said that you are aligning with, if you do nothing, nothing will happen. And like I've said before, we don't have time, much time anymore. We're still going to be alive, but we don't have much time anymore. Because at some point, God is going to be asking all of us, what did we do while we were in Sault Ste. Marie? For some of us, we've lived our entire lives in this city. For me, and my wife is coming to a very, to a close at some point. And the question I keep asking myself is, what have I been doing in this city? Did I meet enough people to tell them about the love of God? Or did I just stay in the confines of church, waiting for the time Pastor Ben is going to call me to preach? What was my life saying? What kind of conversations did I have with people? I've been praying for the salvation of the city, but what kind of conversations was I having with people? Were they the edifying ones that would lead them to Christ? Or were they just everyday gist, you know? These are the things that determines whether our prayers will be answered or not. And so God is calling us to a place of prayer. If you're retired, you're enlisted, pray at least 1 hour a day for the city. That would be great. Amen? So the onus rests on us. The things that we're looking to God for, they are not far away. The things that we're looking for are looking for us. The answers you are asking God for are asking you to make a move. Spend the time praying. We have to grow in our spirit. Something else I need to mention here is if you do not pray in the spirit or you do not pray in tongues as a Christian, chances are that you are cheating yourself out of a lot. Because there's only so much you can pray in your own language. There's only so much you can pray in your own language. You can pray the things that you know. But when you pray in the Spirit, the Holy Spirit helps you to pray. And so there are more things that you can communicate with God that God will drop inside your heart to pray about that will help your life move forward and better. And so if you don't pray in tongues or you don't pray in the spirit, yes, you will have a lot of stuff, but you won't have everything that God has for you. So when you pray, you have to pray in the most effective, use all the tools that God has made available. And that is the way you thrive. Amen? Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you because we know that you are more willing to answer prayers than even our readiness to ask. And so, God, we look up to you today. We pray that even as we've reminded ourselves over these past weeks about prayer, that you will cause your Holy Spirit to teach us. Teach us in our private homes. Teach us in our hearts. Remind us everything that we have shared that we have shared in church today and other weeks and every message that continually comes to us from this pulpit. Father, we pray that you'll help us to grow. Help us to know that there's not enough time to just while away the days, but there's so much to do for the kingdom, so much to do for the kingdom. And help us to stand up to the challenge, to pray for the lost, to seek the lost, and be the tools that you would use to help others grow in their faith, to find you. And at the end of the day, we want to get to heaven and know that we did not just make heaven, but we actually have rewards waiting for us because we listened to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
It's wonderful how you chose the final two songs last week, but they go perfectly with the message this morning. Praise the Lord. So the excitement builds. For our first place and second place songs, we're going to enhance our whole heritage experience because we're going to use the hymn books. Now that's heritage. So if you have a hymn book in front or look behind in the pew behind, I'll give you a little background. So our second place hymn was written in 1855, and it has a Canada connection. Joe Scriven penned this poem and song to comfort his mother, who was living in Ireland while he was living in Canada. Second place, what a friend we have in Jesus. I'll tell you. No. We rehearsed this at home. I'm living in Sioux, Michigan, so it's... And I told him, don't press that button. I still have to tell a story. Okay. The Lord keeps us humble. So What a Friend in Jesus has a special memory for me. So Elam's former Reverend Ross Schwint, he's the father of our dear Pastor Marilyn Schwint, Burmaster. He would choose this song for a Sunday service. And when we would be going to play it, he would instruct us. He'd say, now I want this song upbeat because it's happy and it's full of hope. So play it upbeat. So turn to page 403 in the hymn book. And the choir is going to join us. And you're going to stand with me and sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Now.
What a privilege to carry
Was that upbeat? Doesn't that make you feel so confident, as Pastor Steve mentioned? What a song for us to enjoy. And even with our brothers and sisters hundreds of years ago, we still share the same experience. Now, did you pick the first place song? Well, I'm not going to tell you what it is yet. It's the oldest. It was written in 252 years ago, but it is still heard all over the world every day at many venues, occasions, and in the media. Our first place song, Amazing Grace. Yeah? Good one. It was written by John Newton, who received God's grace and mercy despite all the terrible things he had done. And we were just discussing it this morning that this song doesn't have any these or thous or thines in it. It's just the most perfect song that the Lord gave him for all times. Growing up, John Newton rebelled against authority after his mother died when he was six. He became a slave trader and captain of a slave ship. In 1754, John repented of his sins during a violent storm at sea and during an illness. God's amazing salvation completely changed him and set him on a new path. After his salvation, he was instrumental in the abolishment of slavery in England and stopping the slave trade ships. The gospel improved his life and the life of millions of others. He was set free from sin, and the slaves were set free from their bondage. Newton's song of redemption was a gift from God, a divine gift for all generations, and we are blessed to sing these powerful words on page 206. And we're going to sing this a cappella, the first verse without music. I just want to hear your voices sing this as loud as you can. Amazing Grace. To thank you all for participating and being so patient, and I pray that some of these songs will go with you through the week, inspire you as they have inspired many over the centuries. And so I'll pray a blessing on you. God bless you and keep you until we meet again next Sunday. Amen.